We study through books of the Bible here at the Village Chapel. We have extra copies. If you didn't bring one with you and you'd like one to follow along, I invite you to raise your hand. Somebody will be glad to drop a copy off for you. Luke, you're going to be running that again, okay? So thank you so much for running the slides for me up in the booth. Let's give those folks up there in the booth a nice hand. We hardly ever say thanks. Beginning of a year. Thank you, guys. Appreciate you being there. Awesome. So we're in 1 Samuel. We're reaching back over 3,000 years to a time period called the monarchy in ancient Israel, roughly 1060 BC to 586 BC. In the middle of that, there's lots of different kings that come into play. The kingdom is split. There's the northern kingdom, typically called Israel, the southern kingdom, typically called Judah. And around 722 BC, the northern kingdom is decimated and just dismantled by the Assyrians. And so the 10 tribes of the north are carried away. And then coming up in 586 BC, following that, we find Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians come and overrun the southern kingdom, and they destroy Jerusalem and the temple and all of that. 70 years later, God brings some of the remnant back and begins to rebuild and restore his people, and the second temple period comes. And then later, of course, our New Testament picks up with the storyline of Jesus and his life. But preceding all of that, we're back to the very beginning of that monarchy, somewhere around 1050 and 1060. And so chapter 14 is where we're at. When we left off last back in November, chapter 13, Saul, the first king in Israel, the first of the monarchs in Israel, he had done a few things at the beginning that he went out and won some victories, seemed to be a relatively good choice in terms of king. But remember, the children of Israel had clamored for a king just like the other nations. So their desire was to be just like the other nations. And there we're told specifically in 1 Samuel, they rejected Yahweh as king. And they wanted to be just like the other nations. That's what was wrong with their desire to have another king. They didn't want God to be their king. And so he gives them this king, telling them in advance that it's probably going to go south for them, or it will go south for them. And indeed, it starts to show that way in chapter 13, which we've already studied. In chapter 13, Saul's son Jonathan begins to step forward, and he smote the garrison of the Philistines, verse 3 of chapter 13 tells us. But Saul kind of took the credit. We're told that later on, that it was, everybody was talking about how Saul did it. So you start to see his motivation and a few cracks in his character there, this King Saul, and that what he's really concerned about is his own image, his own celebrity. He's more concerned about that. Well, in chapter 14, these two men will be contrasted even more. So I'm going to read the first 23 verses. We'll make a few comments along the way. I've got 3 points to highlight for you. And I think that'll give us a nice sort of a bring us back to speed with the storyline of what's going on in the period called the monarchy. The day came that Jonathan, the son of Saul, this is verse 1 of chapter 14 of 1 Samuel, the day came that Jonathan, the son of Saul, said to the young man who was carrying his armor, and they did have that in those days. They had an armor carrier. This was his cartage company. Basically, his guy that would carry his armor for him when he went out to battle and serve him, sort of like his, you know, caddy in, if you're playing golf, or his cartage guy if you're bringing your instruments. Come and let us cross over to the Philistines' garrison that's on yonder side. Yonder is a funny English word to translate in there, isn't it? I thought, what is it? These guys are from southern Israel, I guess, right? Come on over, let's cross over to yonder side. But he did not tell his father. The narrator is careful to tell us that. Jonathan and this armor bearer go over, and he's not telling his dad what he's up to. Saul, that's his father, was staying in the outskirts of Gibeah under the pomegranate tree. Notice the specificity, the live body detail, which is in Migron, and the people who were with him were about 600 men. That's an interesting number, because in chapter 13, the people who were with him were 3,000. So what you get is the image of a sinking ship, a shrinking army. 3,000 in chapter 13, 2,000 of whom followed Saul, 1,000 of whom followed Jonathan. But now the two are back together, and all that's left is 600 men, 600 soldiers. And the Philistines are, you know, like little terrorists marauding in and through, and they're perennial problem for the children of Israel. And so now this is going to be the same as Jonathan says to his armor bearer, let's go over to the Philistine garrison, but we're not going to tell anybody about it. So there's Saul with his 600 men hanging out in the outskirts of Gibeah. There's a well-known, you know, significant, evidently, pomegranate tree there. And they're basically huddled around this thing hiding, and they're not sure what to do anymore. And everybody is dropping like flies. And that's where Israel's army is at this point, because the king is there. His name is Saul. Along with him is Ahijah, verse 3, the son of Ahitub, Ichabod's brother, the son of Phinehas, the son of Eli. All of that, all of those names, if you were with us for the study, you remember Ichabod, his name means the glory has departed. And if there was anything that could, a phrase that could describe Saul's religious life, or his faith, if you want to call it, his spirituality, it would be that the glory is departed. There's nothing there. There's no real substance to his faith or his relationship with God. He does religious stuff every now and then. He'll do some religious stuff in a minute, but he just does it when it's expedient, and he just does it thinking he can kind of control God, put God on his leash. And you'll see that as we get a little further, but so Saul is there, this one who will become a failed king, and so too are these failed religious leaders, Ahijah, who's related rather to Phinehas, who was the son of Eli, the two sons of Eli who were just completely flat out rejected by God as priests. They took advantage of God's people. They stole from the sacrifices and the offerings that were brought forward by God's people, and God smote them. Well, the people did not know that Jonathan had gone. So twice now we're told that Jonathan's doing what he's doing in secret. He's not making much fanfare out of what he's doing, he and his armor bearer. Between the passes by which Jonathan sought to cross over to the Philistines' garrison, here we're going to get some topography as this narrator is telling us the story. There was a sharp cliff on the one side and a sharp cliff or crag, some of your translations will say, on the other side. The name of the one was Bozez, and the name of the other was Senna. I love it when these names are given to us. I like to go look them up. I did. Bozez means slippery. Senna means thorny. Neither are attractive. If you have to go down Bozez and come up thorny, if you go down a slippery slope and then you cross over to get to the thorny ascent of the other side to fight the Philistines, good grief. How difficult that must be. The one crag, or the one cliff, rose on the north opposite Michmash, the other on the south opposite Geba. Then Jonathan said to the young man who was carrying his armor, come, let us cross over to the garrison of these uncircumcised. And they called the Philistines uncircumcised, not to make some comment on their physical condition or you know, them not having been circumcised, but more to point out the fact that they are not in covenant relationship with God. That's what circumcision was. Physical circumcision for the Jews was a sign of the covenant with God. They belonged to God. They were set apart to God. And so he makes this reference to the Philistines as the uncircumcised one, and he says to his armor bearer, let's go, let's cross over, and then circle the next word in your Bible, whatever translation you have, whatever it says. Mine says, perhaps. Maybe yours says, maybe. Okay? Great word. Perhaps the Lord will work for us, for the Lord is not restrained to save by many or by few. Perhaps. I like that about Jonathan. That he would say perhaps. I say perhaps a lot in my faith life. I don't know about you, because I don't know what God's going to do. There's a whole lot of mystery in this God of the Bible. Amen? Yeah. I think if we were a little quicker to admit that, some people might be a little quicker to believe. Some of us think we got him all figured out. If you've got your God all figured out, you don't believe in God. You're ostensibly just believing in some little g god that you've created yourself. If the title, and it's just a title, God, if that title means anything at all, what it means is so far higher above transcendent that you can't even imagine the beginning of how wise, generous, gracious, forgiving, powerful, awesome, holy, righteous this God is. You know, we live in a day and time, everybody wants to talk about God as love, and certainly he is that. The Bible even says he's love. But a lot of people today think that that's all he is, as if you could reverse that and say love is God. And what they mean by love typically is sort of the warm, fuzzy feeling of love. And man, I love warm, fuzzy feelings. Anybody love, amen? I'm all about love. Give me a warm, fuzzy feeling every now and then. I'm good with this. You know, I go to the movies every now and then, or I watch some TV show even, and I go, honey, they got me again. I'm starting to weep or whatever. It's fine. We're sentimental creatures. That's okay. But here's what I need more than that, more than a warm, fuzzy feeling. I need, you read it at the beginning of this worship service. I need the Psalm 34:18 God who draws near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Because there are 1,000 ways to break my heart. And there are 1,000 ways to break your heart too. And there are 1,000 ways that my spirit can be crushed. And there are 1,000 ways yours can be crushed too. That's the kind of God I need. And that's the kind of God the God of the Bible is. So we, every single week, we draw near to him and we point him out to each other so that we can say, perhaps, maybe, wouldn't it be awesome? He can, you know. I don't know if he will, but I'm still counting on him. Perhaps he will. Let's put our trust and hope in him. Jonathan said, perhaps, to his armor bearer, perhaps the Lord will work for us. The Lord's not restrained to save by many or by few. In other words, God can save any old way he wants to. I'm so quick to prescribe the method in my prayers. Are you that way? Dear Lord, here's this thing that I really am concerned about. And, you know, it would really help if you could take care of it right now. I like my right nows. I like microwave responses from God, you know. Or if you'll just do it this way. Now, how many people, be honest with me, you're sitting in this room today, and when I say this, you identify with this, that there have been times where I was convinced I knew what should happen. I prayed to that end. God, please bring this, for the sake of your good name, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, do it this way now. And it didn't happen. Anybody in the room at all like that, okay? Now, all of you that raised your hands, how many of you now, looking back on that, are just so gratefully didn't say yes? Yeah, that's right. Why? Because he's so wise. He's so much, he knows so much more than I do. He knows so much. That's why it's important that we say perhaps. That's why it's important that we let God be God and not try to take his place. All right, I've got to move on. The armor bearer responds, verse 7. He says, do all that is in your heart, Jonathan. Turn yourself, and here I am with you according to your desire. In other words, I will go with you where, let's do it. Let's go. I trust you. You know, Jonathan said to him, behold, we will cross over to the men and we will reveal ourselves. So here they are going down the slippery slope, across the valley and up the thorny ascent, the thorny cliff. And instead of hiding in the thorns till they get to the top, Jonathan tells the armor bearer, along the way, while we're coming up old thorny, we're going to stick our heads out and go, boo, to the Philistines. We're going to let them know we're coming. How many of us are there? Two. Whoa. That's going to scare them. So we will let them know. But he's got a plan here. Verse 9, if they say to us, wait until we come to you, then we will stand in our place and not go up to them. Verse 10, but if they say, come up to us, then we will go up. And notice this conclusion, for the Lord has given them into our hands, and this shall be the sign to us. Verse 6, it's all about the Lord who perhaps will work for us. The Lord, who is not constrained. There's nobody that constrains God when he wants to save. It doesn't matter if there's just a few of us or hordes of us. The odds never matter to God. I like that. Now he's saying, come on, let's go, armor bearer. You said you're up for it. Let's go. And when we get up there, since we don't know specifically how God's going to save, let's just do this. We'll kind of throw this out. If this happens, then we'll respond this way. If that happens, then we'll respond. Now, that has been me 100 times trying to figure out the will of God in my life. If this happens, oh, I'm getting this message. But if this happens over here, I'm getting this message from God. Is that you? That's Jonathan. He's just like us. He doesn't know. He knows generally the will of God, knows a lot of the will of God, but he knows in specific exactly how this God who can save, no matter how many there are, will save. I'm not sure about that. And so along the way, he's seeking God's guidance. This, if it goes this way, the Lord has given them into our hands, and this shall be a sign to us. That's as clear as a bell. Jonathan is looking for the specific will of God in the context of the general will of God. He's committed to the general will of God, but he's looking for the specific will of God, just like us, okay? And he is looking for God to show him what to do. Are you hungry for God to show you what to do this year? I hope you are. So we begin a new year. What will he show you? What slippery slope will you have to risk? What thorny ascent after the slippery slope? And you know, I just hate it when the thorny ascent comes on the heels of the slippery slope. Because I hate the slippery slope to begin with. I don't like to look at it. I definitely don't like to go down it. And I don't like it when my feet come out from underneath of me and I fall on my posterior and I roll a little. I don't like that. And I don't like it that you got to climb thorniest. And I really don't like facing a garrison of Philistines on the top after all of that. Jonathan's tenacious trust in God leads him to move out all alone, nobody noticing. Nobody even knowing. He doesn't have a GPS. He can't text for help. He just goes because everybody else is just sitting around a pomegranate tree hiding from the Philistines. He's willing to go. And his faith, his tenacious trust in God is so infectious and contagious that a no-named armor bearer is willing to go with him. And so they do. They go. And when both of them revealed themselves to the garrison of the Philistines, verse 11, the Philistines said, behold, Hebrews are coming out of the holes where they have hidden themselves. So here's the Philistines up on top of old Thorny. And they're playing cards, sitting around the campfire. And they hear some rustling of the thorn bushes. And they lean over the edge and go, hey, Goliath, or whatever the name was. Look there. There's one of those guys. There's some Jews are coming out of the caves. You know, we've been marauding through Israel, and we've scared them all into the cave. Now a couple of them are coming out. Let's throw some rocks. No, it doesn't do that. They don't throw any rocks at them. See, Jonathan prayed to the Lord, if they say this, then that. If they say that, then this. And so, behold, the Hebrews are coming out of the holes that they were hidden in, and the men of the garrison hailed Jonathan and his armor bearer, and here's what they say. Come up to us. And we will tell you something. Maybe retranslate that for you. Come on up here. We'll show you a thing or two. You know, because they're the enemy, right? They could have thrown rocks. No, but they do exactly what one of the two things Jonathan hoped they would say to give him some clarity. And they say, come on up here. Now, Jonathan, of course, is emboldened to respond and to do what he believes God has led him to do, and I believe that as well. So he says to the armor bearer, come up after me, for the Lord has given them into the hands of Jonathan? No, Israel. I love it. He's showing himself to be pretty selfless. Not a perfect man, to be sure, but nonetheless, this isn't all about his resume. This isn't all about press clippings for him. He's not going to go tweeting, and I did this. That's not him. He's not that way. The Lord has given them. The Lord is doing this. Verse 6, it's the Lord who, or verse 10, perhaps the Lord will give them into our hands. Verse 12, the Lord has given them into the hands of Israel. Jonathan climbed up on his hands and his feet. Notice how graphic that is. You can see that happening. You see the guys traveling up Mordor, you know, crawling on their hands and feet to get to the top. You know, and his armor bearer was behind him, and they fell before Jonathan, they, the Philistines. His armor bearer put some to death after him. So Jonathan is knocking them down. The armor bearer is coming along and killing some of them that have not died. And that first slaughter, which Jonathan and his armor bearer made, was about 20 men within about half a furrow in an acre of land. So specific here, the information that we're given. And then something very unusual, something supernatural, some additional supernatural stuff happens. There was a trembling in the camp, in the field, and among all the people, meaning the Philistines. Even the garrison and the raiders trembled, and the earth quaked so that it became a great trembling. You know, one of those apocalyptic type moments where the earth is splitting open, there's gases spewing out of the earth itself, and this earthquake is happening, and it's much more. Look, the reason I'm pointing that is it's much more than Jonathan's skilled swordsmanship going on here. It's much more than just mere good luck. This worked out really good. You know, I've prayed for things before, maybe you have too, and things that have actually happened, and then later I go and retrofit the result and sort of take it away from God and say, well, you know, that's the way it was going to go. Science, of course, would prove that that's the way that would go. And so it's clearly, listen, and then when I come to my senses, I want to be the one leper that goes back and says, thank you. I want to be the one that goes back and says, thank you, thank you, thank you. Even though my mind quickly goes to solving it in my head scientifically or philosophically or something. I love it. He's giving credit to the Lord. The Lord shows up and causes everything to tremble. Now notice, it's not over yet. Saul's watchmen in Gibeah of Benjamin looked, and behold, the multitude melted away. So they can clearly see, evidently from the other side of the valley, they can look across and see the Philistine garrison in disarray, the Philistine army beginning to spin and twirl, the earthquake. They don't know what's going on. It's like nuts, right? And the multitude melted away, and they went here and there. And Saul, who's over there by the pomegranate tree near Gibeah, to the people who were with him said, number now and see who has gone from us. In other words, who's causing that stir in the Philistine army? And when they numbered, behold, Jonathan and his armor bearer were not there. My son is gone again. The one that took the victory from me in chapter 13, even though I was able to get the headlines. Then Saul says to Ahijah, bring the ark of God here. In other words, let's do something religious. And in their view, they had done this before. They took the ark, treating it like some kind of talisman, some kind of little genie lamp that they could rub and somehow or another end up with God, you know, in control or in charge of God, is what they thought. Bring the ark of God here. For the ark of God was at that time with the sons of Israel. It happened that while Saul talked to the priest, that the commotion in the camp of the Philistines continued and increased. In other words, they could see it. It got so chaotic over there that Saul then says to the priest, withdraw your hand. In other words, forget the religious furniture. Forget the ark. I don't need that. And Saul and all the people who were with him rallied and came to the battle. So they go flying down slippery, running up thorny, and they join in the battle. Why do you think that is? Because I think Saul wanted to make sure he got there before the victory was finished, so Saul could take the credit for the victory. He doesn't want somebody else to get the victory, especially not his son. So they run. And he tells the priest to keep the ark to himself. He was going to do something religious, but then decided not to. And then verse 21 is so awesome. Look at this. Now the Hebrews who were with the Philistines previously, who went up with them all around in the camp, even they also turned to be with the Israelites who were with Saul and Jonathan. Another, what's happening there? 21 is about traitors, Israelites who had turned traitor and joined the Philistines. And now they are returning back to the Israelites. That's what's happening in 21. And that's what happens when you have that kind of contagious faith. Not only do armor bearers become emboldened to go with you on a mission that surely looks like a total loss, not only are they encouraged to risk the slippery slope and the thorny ascent and to face the Philistines, but even traitors return home because they see something in somebody else that seems authentic and real, and they must really be trusting in Yahweh. Remember Yahweh, the one our grandfather told us about? You know, before we joined the Philistines? Let's go back and believe in Yahweh again. And so these traitors in verse 21 return home. Verse 22, another group. Then the men of Israel who had hidden themselves in the hill country of Ephraim, and Ephraim is very hilly. I've been to Israel three or four times, and it's got five different topographical regions, one of which is where the area, the tribe of Ephraim lived, and yes, lots of hills. And when they had hidden themselves there, in caves in the hills and stuff, and when they heard that the Philistines had fled, even they also pursued them closely in the battle. In other words, Jonathan's faith influenced not only his armor bearer, and not only the traitors to return, but the fearful are fearful no more because they see somebody trusting God. Somebody's willing to risk it all. Somebody's willing to even stand alone or just with one other if they have to be faithful to God in a very high-risk scenario. Verse 23, we'll stop here. So the Lord delivered Israel that day. It doesn't say Jonathan did. It doesn't say Jonathan plus the traitors that returned. It doesn't say Jonathan plus the traitors that returned plus the fearful ones who got brave again. No, the Lord delivered Israel. Who is it that shakes it all? It's the Lord. He shook the earth. He shook the Philistines. And guess what else he did? He shook the traitors. And he shook the fearful. And sometimes he's got to shake me. And sometimes he's got to shake all of us to wake us. And here we are at the beginning of a year, and some of us probably need a shaking, you know, to wake us up spiritually. I don't know where you're at. I haven't got a clue. But if you think the Holy Spirit's speaking to you in that regard, he probably is. I can't say for sure. I don't know. All I know is that I want to be awakened. All I know is that I want to, when he calls me to, I want to step out and follow him. He, Jesus, the greater leader than Saul, the greater leader than even Jonathan, entered into enemy territory all alone and laid down his life, took the slippery slope, the thorny ascent, and actually died, was buried. And then God raised him up again. And I love it that the resurrection is included in virtually every single sermon in the book of Acts. There's so many other little pet doctrines that if you look at today's church, you'd think, oh, that will be in every sermon in the book of Acts. No, it's the resurrection that made all the difference. And it's the resurrection that's the only possible explanation for how the gospel, just a story told by a few peasants and fishermen in a pass-through nation on the, you know, eastern edge of the Mediterranean Sea, somehow or another, that story sweeps the mighty Roman Empire later. How's that possible? Unless some dead guy actually got up from the tomb and walked again, defeating our last and greatest enemy. Really powerful. The Lord delivered Israel that day. And the battle spread beyond Bethaven. So that's just dot, dot, dot. We got more story to come, and I'm excited for all of it. 1 Samuel 14 presents a clear contrast between two leaders, Jonathan and Saul. Leaders should be courageous, faithful, selfless, true servants of those they're supposed to be serving as they lead. You can contrast Jonathan and Saul pretty quickly. It's pretty easy. Jonathan's courageous act, Saul's inaction. Jonathan's tenacious trust in God, Saul's faux spirituality. I believe in God. Well, it's convenient. I'll even try a little magic trick with that ark once in a while. But I'm really concerned about me looking good. And so I'll show up in the building on Sunday, but it doesn't really mean anything to me. Jonathan's indifference, if he had any, was to limelight, to fanfare, to celebrity. He didn't care about that. That's why he went in secret. We're told that twice. His dad didn't know. The people didn't know. It didn't matter to him about that. He wanted to be faithful to God. And so here is all of that. That's so infectious, Jonathan's leadership. And it made the armor bearer want to follow him. I've said it a million times before. If you're a leader, you know, it doesn't matter how many leadership conferences you go to. It doesn't matter how many books or blogs on leadership you read. It doesn't matter how many leadership podcasts you listen to. If you think you're a leader, but nobody's following, you are merely taking a walk. And you're all by yourself, you know. Jonathan just has this one guy, and then all of a sudden it starts to grow, right? Because he steps out faithful to what God's big picture is. Doesn't know how the small picture is going to go, but trusts God. Armor bearer goes with him. All of a sudden, the crew of people are emboldened and continue to join in the mission that God's doing in that world at that particular moment in time. Now, you can transfer that same kind of principle into our day and time as well. We're the church. We're part of the church in Nashville. You, your mission might be your family, might be your workplace, might be your neighborhood, might be your circle of friends. Are you willing, if God calls you, to step on some slippery slope? Are you willing to ascend some thorny cliff? Are you willing to face some Philistines if you have to? Is your trust and hope and confidence in God the kind of thing that will lead others to just look at you? Or will they be curious about the God you believe in? This Jesus whom you trust with all of your life, all of your heart, as we come to the beginning of the year. These are good questions, I think, for us to ask. Leadership, Andy Crouch says, in Strong and Weak, begins the moment that you are more concerned about others flourishing than you are about your own. God, give us a real concern for those around us, that we actually care about their eternal destiny as well as their present relationship with God. Give us a real love for those around us, whether they're family, friends, neighbors, coworkers, whatever, that we might live out the gospel in word and deed in front of them, and that we might make Jesus and his love for them visible in some way. Secondly, there are lessons here in theology. There are lessons in leadership, but there are lessons in theology as well. Contrast Jonathan's view of God with Saul's. Jonathan believed God was trustworthy and that God was engaged with his people. Do you believe that? I think it really matters. I think it really matters whenever we need direction and correction, because I need both. A lot of us think we're the last word. We don't need any correction. But we do. We need correction. And we need direction. Almost all of us would admit we need direction. Some of us might not admit we need correction. But we got to humble ourselves before this God, because if God means God, and you're not God and I'm not God, then we should fall on our knees. We should worship him. He's the one that can put the song "It Is Well" in our hearts when the circumstances around us are slippery slopes and thorny ascents. He can actually put that song in our hearts. The guy who wrote that song had just lost four daughters in a boat accident out on the high seas, a ship accident. And he wrote, "When sorrows like sea billows roll." That's pretty amazing. Faith in a pretty amazing God. But lessons in theology are abundant here as well. Jonathan trusted God in all the ways, I think, that really matter when you look back on it. No matter what odds he faced, the God of the Bible was trustworthy. He knew that God was faithful and powerful. And even in the darkest of hours, facing insurmountable odds, with a very difficult road to hoe, he trusted Yahweh. Erwin McManus says, God could use a lot of people or only a few people. The odds are irrelevant to God. That book, Seizing Your Divine Moment, is actually all about this one particular Bible story. I think 12 or 14 years ago, we used that book in a men's group here at the Village Chapel. I just remembered that quote, and it stuck with me all of this time. Thirdly, not only are there lessons in theology and lessons on leadership here, but there are lessons in discerning God's will. Jonathan was eager to serve God, seeking to fulfill God's purposes for his life and the life of his country. He resolved to obey God's will, even in anonymity and at great personal risk. Is that me? Is that us? No matter what the odds are, no matter whether there's any fanfare, no matter whether there's anybody noticing it or not or whatever, I'm going to choose to hallow God's name like we pray, to live in his kingdom as if it's come in my life and my heart, which means he's my king. I'm not my king. The culture's not my king. He's my king, right? And to hallow his name. I don't know if you've ever struggled with discerning, well, what's God's will when it comes to this or to that or whatever? And I think this is a great example of that. And I love it that the Bible's honest about Jonathan trying to figure that out as well. Gives me great hope. But God's not like a machine. He's not like some kind of little vending machine, put in the right coins and you get out of it the right, whatever you choose, you push the button, okay? Stott said it this way, praying is not like using a coin-operated machine or a cash dispenser. The struggle involved in prayer lies in the process of coming to discern God's will and to desire it above everything else. Then God will work things out providentially according to his will for which we have prayed. In other words, pray not just for your desired end in the circumstances, but just pray for his will. I'm going to join Jesus in that Gethsemane prayer. Not my will, but yours be done. There Jesus facing the cross, literally himself, asking if this cup could pass, let it, but not my will, but thine be done. That's a great prayer. Don't let anybody ever tell you it's not. I know there's a whole strain of theology. People say, no, that you don't have faith if you say, thy will be done. Or you know what? If it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. I'm going to join him in that prayer. And Stott's comment here, so good too. Jonathan had an authentic faith in God. He really wanted to know what God's will was. He was resolved to it, even if it cost him his life. Keller says, if a religion isn't different from the surrounding culture, if it doesn't critique and offer an alternative to it, it dies because it's seen as unnecessary. The early church surely looked like it was on the wrong side of history, but instead it changed history with a dogged adherence to the biblical gospel. I want that to be said of us when somebody looks back years from now. Look at that group of Christians in Nashville, including the ones that went to the Village Chapel and called themselves the Village Chapel. They tenacious, like Jonathan, tenacious faith, tenacious trust in a God who could save with few or with many or with none, but a God who could save. He's mighty to save. And he is eager. He draws near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. No matter how your heart got broken, no matter how your spirit got crushed, cry out to him, call out to him. He's eager to be your savior, your redeemer, and your king. I want to close in a strange way, kind of the way we begin each of our worship services. We do a call to worship. You read aloud. We all read aloud together. And I like that. But as we begin the new year, let's start off with a renewed commitment to Jesus. And when you see these things up on the screen, if they express the desire of your heart and your commitment to Christ as well, then I'm encouraging you to verbalize that with me, okay? And I've just tried to do it in such a way that I think it's pretty straightforward and easy for all of us. But we don't do lots of altar calls and things like that here at our church, but we need to have defining moments. We need to have moments where we commit and recommit ourselves to Him. Not fluffy little New Year's things that we're going to forget in 2 weeks because it's too frustrating to try and live up to what our standards were or whatever, or what somebody else's standards were. But no, this is about our commitment to Christ Himself, to give all of who we are to all of who He is, and to trust Him like Jonathan did with that kind of reckless abandon, all right? So if this expresses the desire of your heart, join me as we sort of begin this year in this kind of a voiced commitment. Jesus, I surrender all of who I am to all of who You are. Jesus, I give You my mind, my heart, my body, and my soul. Jesus, forgive my sins, cleanse my heart, renew my mind. Jesus, help me see things the way You see things and want the things You want. Jesus, thank You for Your amazing grace and the free gift of salvation. Jesus, fill me with Your Holy Spirit. Send me out into the world to live for Your glory, for the good of my neighbors, and for the furtherance of the gospel. Amen? That's a great way to start the year. I hope you're committed. I hope you're in on this as well. Whether that means we got a slippery slope ahead of us or a thorny ascent or some Philistines to face, whatever. We want to belong to our Lord, our King. We want to be willing to serve Him and His purposes. We want to set aside ourselves. Jesus, the greater leader than Saul, the greater leader than Jonathan, called us to do one thing with ourselves. Deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Me, He said. That's what it means to follow Jesus. And I think it's real important for us to highlight that at a time like this, especially as we open a new year. Ready to deny yourself, ready to take up your cross, ready to follow Jesus. May that be so for each and every one of us.